Hi, I'm Vidit Bakshi. I look after the technology piece of Lucidus as Director Technology. I have been in the cybersecurity industry from last 8 or 9 years since my school time. Earlier, more of as a passion, and now mostly as a profession. So in this video, we are intending to show you how exactly a web application can be compromised through the SQL injection attack, and the confidential data of the same can be leaked. If you're a developer, you'll also get to see how exactly you can patch at the end of the video as well. So to demonstrate you the same, we will be using an application called DVWA, which is publicly available, and so that you can download and configure the same in your computer and practice. the whole and sole intent of this video is to give a detailed understanding of the to the viewers that how exactly injections take place. It is necessary to understand the SQL injection as a concept first. The moment we speak about the SQL injection, it's about an injection which takes place and between the application page, application code page, and the database. So I'm sure all of you understand that any dynamic page which is taking a user input and sending the data to the database, if that is not validated properly, the probability of having a SQL injection is high. As an example, any dynamic page will be having a get method or the post method, or maybe a authentication page which is asking you for a username and password. So let's assume that this is the dynamic page that that you come across. So when you are visiting a page something like this, which is asking you for a username and password, in the back end, the SQL query would be something like select star from X table, since we don't know the table name, where username equals to something and password equals to something as well. Now, so I'll just add some random username and password and try to see if I'm successful to log in or not. It says invalid username and password. Since for our ease, I'm just going to change the password fields type from password to text. So that we can see what I'm entering out there. Alright, so since the query will be going something like this, as an attacker, what probably I can type is single quote or single quote 0, single quote 0. It is necessary to understand what happens the moment we insert this data. Okay, so now the moment we enter single quote or single quote 0, single quote equals to single quote 0 as a password, this becomes the first part of the entire SQL query, and this becomes the second part of the SQL query with the OR as an operand. The first part says select star from X table where username equals to something and password is blank. Option number 2, 0 equals to 0. We all know that 0 equals to 0 is universal truth. Hence, the moment I enter this as my password, this is a password, I will be logged in. Right? Since this is a demo, since this is a test application and only for the demonstration purpose only, there is no data inside that we can see. Along with this, the same can be attempted in other applications as well. Like out here, I'm requesting user ID 1 seeing the data, user ID 2 seeing the data. Just a second, let me log in again. Yeah, make sure your security level is set to low when you are practicing. 2, 3, right? Likewise. And if you want to see all the data, the moment we put our query in along with the actual input out here, we are able to see all the data, right? What does that mean is it either bypasses the authentication or gives you all the data from the that particular query string. This particular injection is known as the authentication bypass injection, which is very basic, and it's obviously, it goes without saying that majority of applications in today's time will not be vulnerable to this as well. Then why did I show you? It was obviously an essential building block to understand the next injection that I'm willing to demonstrate out here. So the next injection that I will be interested in demonstrating out here is something called union-based injection. Probability of applications being vulnerable to union-based injection is still there. So that, and this is something which, you know, we also see in many applications in today's time as well. So let me just open up an application for our demonstration. Yeah. So out here, we can see a get parameter, right? It's not necessary to have the get parameter only. It can be a post parameter as well. If it is post parameter and you need to see all the details, you can use something called burp suit to capture all the post parameter requests and perform the entire assessment. I'm not connected with network. You'll not be able to see the screen on my page. However, you can download the burp suit and capture the request which is going out of your system, and you can capture basically an HTTP request, and you can insert all this injection points over there as well. Now, so union-based injection is again quite straightforward as well. So out here we can see that it user input is being accepted. So let's say if I enter 1, I can see the data. Interest is badminton and gender is female. The moment I take it to 2, it is football and gender is male. And with 3, it, since the user ID 3 does not exist, the data does not present over there as well. In order to check whether the application is vulnerable to this attack or not, I'll simply add one single code and see whether application returns any error or not. Yes, application is returning an error. And we can see out here in the error, it is clearly visible that my single quote, which I added as an input, has gone in the SQL query. If you can observe, there are 2 single quotes in the starting and there are 3 single quotes in the end. So my single quote has also gone as a, as a value. And this, but however, SQL considers the same as an SQL statement and returns the error. Let me patch the error by adding a comment. So hyphen hyphen space is used to add the comment. Since I'm passing the same from the URL, I'll keep hyphen hyphen plus, and I have patched the query. So whatever is there added after my hyphen hyphen space, that is comment. So any query return after that gets avoided as well. Now, let's try to assume the queries, what is going in the backend. The query probably running would be select star from user table where user ID equals to 1. You added another single quote which caused a problem. You have added a hyphen 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 space to avoid the problem. Now, in order to identify how many columns are there in the SQL query, you need to sort the column by doing order by 1. So let's assume that there are X number of columns. If the SQL query has at least one column out here, it will sort it and it will display the result. If it displays the result, a positive result, I will increase the number to 2. It will again check if there are 2 columns, it will perform the sorting. It will show me a positive result on the page. I'll keep increasing the number until I see the error. Assuming that, let's say there are 5 pages, or so, sorry, there are 5 columns in the SQL query, and the moment I put 6, it gives me the error. This gives me a clear idea that there are 5 columns in the SQL query. Let's try to understand this. Let's try to execute this. Order by 1 is loading absolutely normally. Order by 2 is again loading absolutely normally. Order by 3 is again loading absolutely normally. 4, 5, 6. 6 does not exist. Let's try the same on the DVWA. I've applied a single quote, and you can see single quote gives us the error. Here again, you can see additional single quote added as a SQL query statement. I'll remove that additional single quote by adding a comment and then add order by 1, order by 2, order by 3, which says error. So it can be understood in the DVW applications there are 2 columns, and in the Wave application there are 5 columns in this particular SQL query. Once we know the number of columns, we should be able to use union statement. Now, union statement is used in the SQL to execute multiple select statements together. The only condition in the union statement is that, assuming that there are 2 SQL statements from users, and the second is from user 1. If we try to union this, it will certainly give us an error, because the number of columns out here in the right side of the query is 2, where in the left side of union it is 3. The condition that union has, the number of columns in the left should be equal to right. So out here, if I put, let's say, 1 is a constant, so it will obviously simply return 1. The same way, since we don't know the, since we now know the number of columns which is in the left in both the Wave as well as DVW application, we will simply put union select 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or in the case of DVWA, only 1, 2. Let's execute and let's see the result. Oh, okay. So you can see 1 and 2 being displayed out here. Wherein in this case you are not able to see the data getting displayed. Sometimes you don't see the you don't see the data coming from the right side of the SQL query, just simply because the page which is displaying the data, it's only capturing data, or it's only displaying data resulted from the left side of the query. In order to make it happen, or in order to see the data of the right side of the query, you can simply negate the results shown by the first query. And I have added minus out here, hence the ID equals to minus 2 column probably would not even exist in any database. Hence, I can see the result from the right side of the query. It is to be noted that out here I have written 2 and 3, hence I am able to see 2 and 3 out here. If I assume, let's say, if I add 22 and 33, I'll be able to see the same, right? So again, to understand that these numbers are constants, and it just simply displays constant as it is, nothing else, right? Now out here, instead of 22 and 33, I can execute a database function and see the name of the database, which is project. I can even execute a version function and I can see the version of the database is 10.1.16 MariaDB. And I can see the user, which is root @localhost. Same thing can be done in the DVW application. You can see 1 and 2 out here. Version function gives the version. User would again be the same. Let me just simply fetch database, and database name is dbwl. Now we are going closer to the final verdict of the data. In order to fetch the data, we need to fetch the data from the metadata or the master data that is called information schema. In the information schema, which is a master database or a metadata database, there is a tables called tables. Inside, there are few columns, and one of those column is table underscore name. The way name explains itself, table underscore name column contains names of the table, and tables table contains table details. So I'll simply execute the query in this way, wherein in the place of users function, I will put the name of the column, which is table underscore name, from information underscore schema dot tables. The first table name that I can see is guest book. If I want to see all the table names all together, I can do group underscore concat to concatenate all the tables and see the results. And as a result, I can see one of the table name to be users. Same thing can be done in the DBW application. I'm going to simply put table underscore name from information underscore schema dot tables, right? I can again see guestbook and users. You can always be more specific by providing a name of the database where table underscore schema equals to DBWA. So guestbook and users belongs to DBWA database, wherein for the wave, table underscore schema equals to project CSRF CSRF 3 union 1 and users underscore 1 is the table name out here. So we got the table name as well. The way information schema had one table called tables, the same way information schema has another table called columns, and there is an additional column called column underscore name. Again, the name implies the result itself. Column underscore name stands for the column names, which contains the name of the columns, and columns table contains all the details about the columns. Let's try to quickly fetch the column underscore name details. Column underscore name from information underscore schema dot tables, where table underscore name equals to users underscore one, and columns, and we can see the column names to be ID, username, password. The same thing can be done in the DBWA, wherein simply column underscore name and information schema dot columns, where table underscore name is users user ID, first name, last name, user, password, right? So I'll stick to user and password column. And lastly, the query is obviously very simple, wherein we pull out the data. I'll stick to user from users. And we got the usernames to be Edmund, Gordon, B1337, Pablo, and Smithy. Same thing can be executed in this wave application, wherein username and password to be the column names. Username from users1. to be admin, and let's try to fetch a password. Sometimes the password can be very weak. As an example, the moment I try to fetch the password is password, and in sometimes the password can be MD5 encrypted hashes as well. These are the encrypted passwords, which generally as a security best practice, organizations encrypt their passwords so that even if they get compromised or even if their database gets compromised, the user account details or maybe the credit card details or debit card details stay secure and safe. However, reversing of these hashes is relatively difficult as compared to identifying the probability of hack already available. So simply take the hash and put it in the Google, let me just connect. And as a result, we can see that this is again a password, that reverse MD5 is password. Let's try to see the some other characters, password, other MD5 hashes, password. Which is ABC123. Also, it is to note that all these passwords are weak. If it was a strong password, instead of, let's say, the password to be Charlie, if the password was something like Charlie Do C capital, instead of A it was @ sign, and instead of E it was 3, now relativity of this password being discovered simply by googling up the MD5 hashes is difficult. So this is how SQL injections occur in the web applications. In order to patch the same, the developers obviously are supposed to, one is the rigorous user input filtering, wherein, let's take an example, if you are accepting a integer input from your users, there is no reason for allowing a user to type string. So you can do a whitelisting or blacklisting approach for a first level of input. However, to protect your applications from SQL injections in the best way, you should ideally use parameterized query or, if the parameterized queries don't work for you, you can ideally use stored procedures. I would ideally recommend stored procedures to be used by all the developers, as in simply because all the user inputs will be strictly considered as a value and will never be a part of any SQL statement. Versus as compared to the parameterized queries as well, there are certain ways in which it can be bypassed as well. Application developers, from the organization's point of view or from the server's manager's point of view, if you still need to patch this application from a server level, you can actually deploy a web application firewall like Mode Security, which is again open source and freely available on your server, and you can have filtration of such attacks, not just SQL injections, also cross-site scripting, CSRF, and multiple attacks. You can actually have a filtration of the same. So I guess this video ends over here, and thank you so much. If you have any questions, feel free to write it to us. Thank you so much.